probably figured out by now that the topic is removing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence. If you don't know, that's a direct access point to A Course in Miracles. A Course in Miracles is an interesting document. It's about 1,300 pages long. It was transmitted from Jesus to Helen Schuckman, who was a self-described Jewish agnostic, professor of psychology at Columbia Medical School. And you can rest assured that she wanted her colleagues on the medical school faculty to know that she was channeling Jesus. Like she wanted to jump off the Brooklyn Bridge. So her name does not appear in this book. It is not her writing. And it speaks for itself. I'm going to do something that I rarely do, but I'm going to read from the introduction. This is A Course in Miracles. It is a required course. Only the time you take it is voluntary. Free will does not mean that you can establish the curriculum. It means only that you can elect what you want to take at a given time. The course does not aim at teaching the meaning of love, for that is beyond what can be taught. It does aim, however, at removing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence, which is your natural inheritance. The opposite of love is fear, but what is all-encompassing can have no opposite. This course, therefore, can be summed up very simply in this way. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Herein lies the peace of God. A simple statement. But how in the world do we remove the blocks to the awareness of love's presence? Well, it's simple, but it's not easy, because we hang on to our thinking even when it makes us miserable. We find some level of comfort in hanging on to the thoughts we've always been sort of comfortable with. And what gets in the way? It's as simple as this. If you are talking about the human vascular system, if you were to take a rubber band and wrap it around your finger several times, your finger might begin to change color. It might begin to suffer from the lack of vascularization. But the minute that you take that rubber band off, the vascular system comes flooding into the finger and restores it to health. So we have put rubber bands on our thinking, our soul. We have covered up what seems to be what's going on in the world. We have grievances, judgments. We have beliefs that get in the way. We believe in littleness. We think, oh, well, I'm only human. I couldn't possibly do this or that or the other thing. We believe that we are limited. And the fact is that divine intelligence is in us as the Holy Spirit. And it's there right now. What's not there is a clear channel access to our mind. We suffer from a split mind. We think we are our body, and we believe in the reality of the body. We do it. Even those of us who've been course students for 30 years do the same thing. I have a little health challenge right at the moment, and what really annoys me is that I believe it's real. I believe that I have to take some more pills. Where are my pills? That's what I'm working on. Because I have a belief in limitation. I have a belief in littleness. There are all kinds of beliefs that get in the way. Belief in lack, in limitation. Oh, there's not enough. There's not enough money to go around. Will I be able to have enough money to live as long as I live? For those of us who were born in a certain decade, that gets to be a serious issue. We worry about that all the time. And why would we worry? The one thing that I can say with unequivocal, straightforward accuracy is that worry has never, ever solved a single human problem. Ever. And all it does is make you miserable. And why would you choose to make yourself miserable? Oh, I'm having fun. I'm miserable. Yay. I don't think so. Love's presence is your divinity. The Holy Spirit. It is in you. And what gets in the way is your thinking that it isn't. You can be one of the three monkeys. Hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil. Hear no truth, see no truth, and speak no truth. Just change that around a little bit, and that's what we do. We choose to make ourselves miserable. And why would we do that? Well, one of the things we've learned is that that's how the world is. Didn't you know? Weren't you educated? Didn't you grow up being told you have to work hard and study hard and get good grades and get ahead? Maybe it's true. Maybe it's not true. Who could say? But the Course itself is a guide to behavior. And all behavior is based on what you believe. Everything that one does is based on their belief system. No question about it. And beyond even that, everyone, and I mean everyone, operates on the basis that they are doing what they think is appropriate given their understanding of the way the world works and how it's supposed to be. Now that's pretty hard to swallow sometimes, because we look out in the world and we see behaviors that really are shocking, that really make us wish that it were different. Millions of people walked yesterday to establish that point. But our thinking has grown to be our comfortable friend, even though it makes us miserable, even though it causes us to be stressed out, to be disease-ridden. Dis-ease is a lack of peace. One of the things that's true is that if you were able, and we're all able, we're just unwilling, if you were able to change your thinking, everything in your life would change. One of the most dramatic examples of a change in thinking happened to a woman named Anita Morjani, who checked into a hospital in Hong Kong, suffering from stage 4B lymphoma. So 4B is even further advanced than 4. And we all know that stage 4 isn't a happy place to be. She had tumors bulging out all over her body, and she was in the early stages of organ shutdown. And the doctor who admitted her to the hospital said to her husband, "I'm not sure she's going to make it through the night." And one of the things that happened to her during that night was that she had a near-death experience. And she went to the other side and had a conversation with her father and a friend who had died of cancer some years previously. And she came to the conclusion that she was doing it right and that she didn't need to worry about how she was going to be. She grew up in a multicultural world. Her parents were Indian. They lived in Hong Kong in a Chinese culture. She had a Chinese nanny. And she went to a Catholic school. And she had no idea who she was. And she worried about it all the time. And the minute that she got clear about how that was okay, that her father thought she was great, didn't worry about whether she was a good Indian daughter. Of course you are. And it was a revelation to her. And that instantaneous change of thinking began a process of complete healing. Within 3 weeks, all of the tumors were gone. And she was discharged from the hospital some weeks after that, completely healed. Doctors have flown from all over the world to Hong Kong to look at the medical records because they cannot believe that someone in that advanced state of disrepair was healed. And you can rest assured that it had nothing to do with a magical chemo or radiation or anything, because that didn't change what happened. So you can see that when you align your mind with divinity, when you align your thinking with divine thinking, you can change how the world is, your world. Vivekananda, one of the great Hindu swamis, said this: in the springtime, observe the blossoms as they disappear while the fruit grows. They don't struggle with the fruit. One simply supplants the other. So it's not stressing out or arguing with what is. It's simply tuning in to the process and being happy is a matter of choice. And that seems hard to believe. But it is a matter of choosing the thoughts and the beliefs that most fully allow your mind to express its inner truth in your own life experience. So what's really true is that you are the only one who has any control over your thinking. No one can change your thinking for you. They might be able to suggest an idea that would give you cause to change your mind, but only you can change your mind. You are in charge of the rubber bands. You are, not anyone else. So, what does that tell us? The blocks to the awareness of love's presence are self-created. Self-created. And that's troublesome because we all think of ourselves as innocent in some way or another. Well, I certainly didn't intend to do that. What? How did that happen? Well, it happens in the process of living in a three-dimensional world of duality. We're always taught about good and evil and bad and good and all of the dualities that exist in the world. And we are taught language by definition. Language itself is duality. Language is not oneness. Language is microphone, podium, flowers, difference, not oneness. So just the process of thinking gets in the way of our ability to tune in to our divinity. In another work that's channeled from Jesus, he suggests that the mind is a wonderful tool. Wonderful tool. It helps you measure things. It helps you keep track of things. It helps you organize things in the world. But he says emphatically, that it is never, was never, ever designed to be in charge. The heart is designed to be in charge. And the heart is what we're called on to tune into, to allow the blessings that are wrapped up in our heart. The divine presence is there, waiting simply for a welcome. Okay. I don't know if that's a basketball game. Football game or what. So, it's a process of letting go of our thinking. Only our thinking gets in the way. And if we can access our actions from our heart, if we can establish our belief system from the heart, we will make a huge difference. We will make a difference in the world, and we will let go of our thinking that I got to do something to correct this problem. And the answer is be fully present. And like the petals on the blossoms, simply drop away when it's time for the fruit to show forth. Or as Nancy read this morning from Rumi, let go of all of that stuff. Don't worry about the mirror. Let the heart be in charge. So now it's open mic time. Lindsay.